Good to see you this morning. Come on, stand up. Come on, let's stand up. Let's get ready to worship the Lord together this morning. Lay down my life. I will abandon all of my pride. Focus my eyes away from myself. You become greater, I become less. You be lifted high. You be lifted higher. I belong to you. I am nothing without you. You be lifted high. You be lifted higher. I belong to you. I am nothing without you. Jesus, be all. Consume every part. My greatest desire, I give you my heart. Focus my eyes myself. You become greater, I become less. You be lifted high. You be lifted higher. I belong to you. I am nothing without you. You be lifted high.
You be lifted high. Church, we're so glad that you're here today. It's good to see you, church family. And if you're visiting with us today, we're so glad that you chose to be with us, and we'd like to know more about you. We have a communication card you can find in the back of the pew, and you can fill that out for us, letting us know more about you. And church family, you don't need to feel left out, as always. If you've got some information you need to share with us, you can use that as well. You can add that to it. Sorry, we're just enjoying the moment. All right, so the back of the card, raise your hand if you know what this is for. We just didn't have anything else to print on it. But since that's the case, we have lines there, and we can put prayer requests there, right? And listen, I've talked to several people this morning. We have things that we need to be praying about, amen? I mean, just we do this all the time. Just raise your hand if you could desperately use some prayer right now. Just look around the room. That's all of us. All right, how many of you got things that you just want to give praise and thanksgiving about. All right, so listen, don't be greedy. Share it with us. Let us know how to be praying for you. Share it with your small group or share it with your Sunday school class. That was a plug for small group, by the way. But we're going to do something. All my introverts, are you ready? I want you to just get up and greet one another this morning. Go ahead and take a few minutes to say hello. As Becky is starting to play a little music in the background to kind of ask a job, let you know that we're making our way back to our seats. As you're heading back to your seats and making your way back to your seats, Zane, we don't have introverts in this church anymore. Everybody's comfortable. Listen, if you're watching us online, church family, if you're not here, we love you. And I hope you feel included and a part. And you know, it's an important part of worship with what we just did. We come together. This is corporate worship. It's not individual worship. And when we come together corporately in worship, when we come together all at the same time to worship, we're bringing in the fruit of the worship that we've had the whole week. So I want to encourage you, if you hadn't been worshiping during the week, you're not going to bring much to the table. So we need to be worshiping. This is not the only time we worship, daily. Amen? So we're going to just continue to worship this morning. And we're going to ask that God would move mightily in this place today, that he would mature us, that he would grow us up, that he would equip us. The world has not gotten any brighter. It's still dark. But the darkness can't overcome the light, no matter how hard it tries. Sickness can't overcome it. Death can't overcome it. We've got a Savior who's conquered sin and death, and our hope is in him. And we are new creations in him, and everything we are from him. So it makes sense that we come here and we worship him. He is what joins us together. It's not the beautiful carpet. It's not the wonderful layout of the church. It's not because this is the happening place in Camden County. We're here for one reason. It's because Jesus Christ saved us from all of our sin and gave us new life. We worship him. Amen. Father, we come before you. Lord, I know that we're sorry sometimes, Father. We come even to a place of worship and we have bitterness in our heart, frustrations, we're aggravated, we're scared, we're fearful, preoccupied, and Lord, I pray that you would give us the power and the strength and ability to push all of that nonsense to the side and worship you with a pure and honest spirit, Lord. That we would reflect on the salvation we have in your Son and what it costs. And Father, that you would equip us today. Lord, that you would encourage us today, that you would rebuke us today, that you would make us grow closer to your Son, that we would be equipped and ready to go out into this dark world and be about the business of our Father, seeking your kingdom first and sharing the good news of salvation in Christ with all we come across. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Every heart that heart is broken. Oh, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out.
Will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Sing this song this morning. It's actually a newer hymn, but written as a very, very old hymn. And so it'll seem very familiar in the way it's structured, but it's actually not that old of a song. But what a tremendous message it really is in it. And as we sing this, I just want to invite you to sing along with us and think about the words that are being said here, because it's such a true, true message and what is said here.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the Holy One bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers.
I know that it is finished.
Ain't that good?
And I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? Oh, I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
Think about that.
Why should I gain from His reward?
Again, y'all ready to get in the Word? We're going to be in John chapter 8 today. You can go ahead and get your electronic devices there or get your Bible there. I've got the Cadillac of microphones today. I didn't know they made them this nice. I got Pastor Ian's mic today. And let me tell you, it is fancy. Man, I'm enjoying it. I've already asked if they can get me one this nice. You guys ready to get in Word? Well, it doesn't matter if you're not, because we're going to. So we're in verses 31 through 47 today, John chapter 8, verses 31 through 47, and we're continuing on our study that we've been doing in the Gospel of John, which has been very rewarding and fruitful. And I want to remind you as we go through, it's a good practice to go back through with your notes. And we're called sheep, and sheep have to ruminate. They have to throw their food back up into their mouth, partially digested, so they can chew it again a second time to get really all the nutrients out of it. And we're much like that with the Word. We don't get it all the first time. And as we go through, and there's verses that jump out to you, commit them to memory. Make them part of your memory plan. If you hadn't been memorizing verses, I want to encourage you, start a plan for memorizing. All right, if you say you can't memorize, then you got bigger problems, because you memorize all kinds of things, birthdays, but the Word of God, we're called to hide it in our hearts. Amen? All right, let's get started. John chapter 8, verse 31 through 47. Verse 31 says, "So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, 'If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.' They answered him, 'We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?' And Jesus answered them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me because my words finds no place in you. I speak of what I have seen with my Father, and you do not, and you do what you have heard from your father. And they answered him, Abraham is our father. And Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would be doing the works Abraham did. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. You are doing the works your father did. They said to him, we were not born of sexual immorality. We have one father, even God. And Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I came from God and I am here. I came not of my own accord, but he sent me. Why do you not understand what I say? It is because you cannot bear to hear my word. You are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell you the truth, you do not believe me. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I tell the truth, why do you not believe me? Whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is that you are not of God. It's a strong message, amen? Strong words. So, the setting of chapter 8, just so we don't lose the full context of this, chapter 8 is carrying over from chapter 7, which began with Jesus being told by his brothers that he should leave Galilee and go to Judea to the Feast of Tabernacles, that he should make himself publicly known, that if you're a prophet, go be a prophet. Otherwise, you're just making us look foolish. So Jesus tells them, you go to the festival. I'm not going to the festival because it's not my time. My time has not come. But after his brothers leave, in secret and privately, Jesus goes to the festival. And in chapter 7, we see that he goes up to the temple courts about halfway through the Feast of Tabernacles, and he begins to teach. And the Jews are amazed at his teaching, and they ask, how did this man get such learning without having been taught? And there's a range of reactions in chapter 7 to Jesus. He's a good man. He deceives the people. He's demon-possessed. And they're torn whether he's the Messiah or not the Messiah. And they tried to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him because his time had not yet come. And it says in chapter 7 that many in the crowd believed in him. And they said to themselves, when the Messiah comes, will he perform more signs than this man? And the Pharisees and the chief priests hear these mutterings and these talkings, and this is a problem, so they need to fix it. So they send the temple guards to arrest him. And on the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus says, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow within them. Everyone goes home, but Jesus goes to the Mount of Olives, spends time with his Father. And chapter 8 begins with, early in the morning, Jesus appears at the temple, and he begins teaching. People gather all around him. He sits down, begins to teach them, and he's interrupted, as you remember, by the Pharisees. They have a plan. They're going to get him. They bring a woman who's been caught in adultery, and they bring her before him as a trap to get him. We're going to get him. We're going to catch him. And then we'll have some evidence against him. And as you know, Jesus begins writing in the sand with his finger, and they keep questioning him and badgering him. And Jesus stands up at them and says, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. And you can see that the words he has right now, he's setting this up even in that moment. Because he knows our hearts, and he knows their hearts, and he knows what he's got to deal with. And once these accusers start leaving one by one, they're gone. And Jesus tells the woman, they're no longer here. And he tells her to go and sin no more. Then Jesus turns to the people that he's been teaching. He says, I'm the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And the Pharisees challenge him. They say, you can't be your own witness. Your testimony is invalid. And Jesus says, I am one who testifies for myself. My other witness is the Father who sent me. And they ask him, where is your Father? So there's a couple ongoing things that are going on. Jesus is bringing up this sin, and they're bringing up, who is your Father? You keep talking about your Father. We have questions about who your Father is too. We'll see more of that. And last week, Zane walked us through the exchange between Jesus and the Pharisees, where he says, you are from below, I am from above. You are of this world, but I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins if you do not believe that I am he. You will indeed die in your sins. And verse 30 ended last week's message with these words, even as he spoke, many believed in him. So we pick up this week in verse 1 with that background. In verse 31, Jesus talks specifically to Jews who believed him. Jesus is now speaking to those who were beginning to believe in him, to those whose hearts are open, to those who have ears, to those who are hearing his words. But this is a unique spiritual place for these Jews. They hear the words of Jesus and they believe him, but they don't really understand the depth of what believing him looks like. Jesus fully understands their hearts. And he begins taking them down a path that will allow them to believe in him fully. Jesus wants their faith to be more than just intellectual, to move into action. You remember in James chapter 2, I'll read it to you if you want to turn there. It's James chapter 2, verse 14 through 22. It says, what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Was not our father Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. Faith is not faith unless it's attached to an action. It's an idea, it's a thought, it's the beginning of it, but it's got to have action. When you trust something, you believe it to be true. This is why so many people have trust issues once they have a relationship and someone's let them down. We have a whole bunch of people that are uninterested in coming to church and being active in church because they've been hurt by the church. They trusted their church family, and their church family hurt them. So now they don't have anything to do with their church or anything to do with church because they don't trust based on their experience. And we can shake our heads and nod, but trust always works this way. We don't know the end result. There's not a relationship in the world that doesn't require trust. They all do. We trust that our children make good decisions. You guys that have children that are older and have moved out into the world, that's a scary place to be, as I'm learning. You've taught them what to do and what's right, and now you have to just trust that they're going to follow what you've taught them. Even though you want to browbeat them and drag them around, it's much easier when they're two. You just tell them what they do and they do it. If they don't, you can pop them on the rear. That doesn't work when they get older, does it? Faith is not faith unless it is attached to an action. And every week we hear Ian say it at the end when we close out that he prays that we're not just hearers of the word, but doers of the word. So we can hear stuff. We can say amen. We can say that's right. We can be in agreement. We can write it down in notes. We can highlight it. We can circle it. We can put little notes on the side of the Bible. But if we're not putting it into action, it doesn't mean a thing. So verse 31, Jesus says to the Jews who had believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You believe in me, but to truly be my disciples, you must do more. If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples." Jesus is saying you must move from hearing to abiding, and there's a difference between hearing and abiding. We can hear something and know it's true, but not act on it. Children here, go clean your rooms. But rarely do they put those words into actions. Occasionally, there's that one special child that just keeps their room clean. Most children clean their room by taking all the junk in their room and stuffing it somewhere. They learn that from their parents. Your laughter confirms that, I guess. We have junk drawers. We have spare closets, spare rooms, garages. Garages are a great place to stuff things, right? The doctor says you need to lose weight. We hear it, but we don't put it in the action. We could go on and on and on. There's many things. And listen, I don't want to get all the wives started, but there's many times you're not sure if your husband heard anything you said at all. Little advice, if your husband's not looking at you when you're speaking to him, he's not listening. He's just not. I know he's in the same room, and it seems like he is. He may be making some deep noises from the gut, there's nothing. Don't pay attention to that. Say his name, make him look at you in the eye, and then whatever you need to say. That's the only way it goes in. Amen, men? Excuse me. Men, look at me. Amen? But abiding is deeper than just responding to something that you hear. Responding and abiding aren't the same thing. Abiding is a daily maintenance of the things that you've heard. Abiding is remembering what you have heard and applying it to your life consistently. Abiding is desiring to be in line with the things you have heard. Abiding is knowing that you can't even function apart from the things that you've heard. Psalms chapter 1 says, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers." Jeremiah 17, verses 7 through 8 says very similar, "But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit." Is that us in this season we're in right now? I was talking to some teachers at my school, and we determined that we don't even know what normal is anymore. We keep saying we just can't wait to get back to normal. Normal is constantly changing. Average is a concept we don't really comprehend. Average looks good, but you got outliers in the average, things that draw that number up or draw it down. And normal is nothing more than us putting the concept of average into daily life. But there is no such thing as normal. Your life is constantly changing. There's new problems, new concerns, new heartaches, new joys every single day that await us. We never know what's coming. Sometimes that's what causes people to be in so much stress. But our confidence is not in the season. It's not in the weather. It's not in the how well we're taken care of. Our confidence is in the Lord and in His Word. And what happens around us can happen. Because the big deal is our relationship with God. But we've got an enemy who deceives us, and he constantly and consistently gets us off track and gets us focused on things that are just not that important. You know, I stayed up past midnight last night. There's a really important thing going on. I had to be committed to it. It was a football game. And just think about that. Is that not nonsense? Surely a responsible pastor would have just turned that TV off and gone to bed, making sure I was refreshed and ready. But no, I had to see who won. Because, you know, whoever wins, that changes my life. Like today, it could have gone either way based on that one game. This team that people don't care about wins and everything's good, but it's not. I have enough experience to know it's not. It really doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, but we're convinced that it is. And we're reminded about this concept of abiding. John chapter 15, Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Oh, how silly we are, though. We try to do a lot without God. Sometimes He's the last person we check in with. I can't tell you how many times I've made plans and worked things out in my mind and just knew how things were going to be. And when they don't work out that way, I turn to God. I'm like, God, I don't understand. And He's probably like, of course you don't. You're supposed to be doing my will. You just laid out your will. My will is so much higher than yours, as the heavens are higher than the earth. If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. If not, you're not my disciples. Faith and obedience are married together for the believer. Faith produces obedience. Obedience is the result of faith. Hebrews chapter 11 tells us about this, kind of paints this picture for us. Verse 1 says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. That in itself seems crazy to the world. Faith is the confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients are commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command. So what is seen was not made out of what was visible. Verse 6 says, and without faith, it's impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith. Verse 8 says, by faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even when he did not know where he was going. All these people, verse 13 says, all these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. You see, we can't proclaim to place our faith in His Word and then live in disobedience to His commandments. And Hebrews gives us not only the description, it gives us examples. And we could keep going, example after example after example. By faith, Noah. By faith, Abraham. Put your name in there. By faith, put your name there. And then what is it that you're obedient to? What is the obedience in form of action that you have? How is your faith reflected by your actions? What exactly is it that you're being obedient to God in right now in this moment, this season of life? British theologian Randolph Tasker, RVG Tasker, that's great initials, makes me want to get more initials, RVG Tasker, he described what it means to abide in His Word. He said, welcoming it, being at home with it, and living with it so continuously that it becomes part of the believer's life, a permanent influence and stimulus in every fresh advance in goodness and holiness. May this be us. May we abide in His Word so continuously that it's a part of us. And there's great reward for abiding in His Word. Jesus tells us three things. It makes us true disciples. It allows us to know the truth. And it sets us free. If you abide in My Word, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Freedom is impossible without truth. And truth exists only in the Word, in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The result of abiding in the Word of Jesus is we prove ourselves to be His disciples, and we know the truth. There's a Christian apologist, Greg Banson, that said the following. We at times hear people declare, I cannot believe that. A close relative has been convicted of a heinous crime. Someone is injured. Just this past week, I had a young man that he was in the first group of kids that I coached at Camden Middle. He was in my classroom as a student. He later came back as a young man and served on my coaching staff, and I coached with him, and he passed away this week. Very young man from COVID issues and complications. And when I saw that, even though I've been praying for him, I knew the struggle was there, I said to myself, I just can't believe it. I can't believe it. There's times when we say, I cannot believe that. But what this Christian apologist says is, but we all realize that the cannot here should be interpreted as will not. Because one does not want it to be true. Cannot emotionally afford to admit that it's true. Almost thinks it's his duty to resist it, or lacks the intellectual energy to rise to the occasion. We often swing between belief and unbelief because deep down, like C.S. Lewis, we don't want to be interfered with. We want freedom and truth on our terms because we recognize that the truth makes us free, but first it makes us miserable. That's not my words or thoughts. The truth makes us free, but first it makes us miserable. Amen. You ever had to share some news with someone that you knew was not going to be well received, but you knew it was good for them? They didn't know. This is the heart of parenting, constantly hurting your little kids' feelings. Their little perception, they see things in such a way. You know, I spend a great deal of time on phone with parents. The kid goes home, explains this heinous thing that's happened to them by the teacher. This horrible, mean, hateful creature that is just robbing their life of their child's life of just freedom and liberties. All their kid wanted to do was go outside and play at recess. But they had to sit in. And I've got a parent, they're just, that's wrong. Kids need to play. I agree. And your child has played all day long in the classroom. That's why they missed recess. Because when they were in the classroom, they're supposed to be doing some work, they were playing. Matter of fact, I think they got the better deal of it because it's 20-minute recess, but they got a couple hours of playing in. Perception. We want freedom and truth, but we want it on our terms. Verse 33 says, they answered him, "We are the offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" You can see that they believe, but they're confused because they're deeply embedded into some thought processes here. Have you ever been talking to someone and they're hearing you, but they're not hearing you? The words are going in, but the brain's not processing it, and you can see that. Is that frustrating? And that's what's going on here. The reaction of the religious leaders is focused on freedom and not obedience. They've just missed the whole point. And this is pretty typical, even today. We view ourselves as free already, even though we are slaves. We view ourselves as good already, even though our hearts are desperately evil and sick. Go out into the world and try to convince them that they're slaves. You're a slave to sin. No, I'm not. I'm a good person. There's no one good. Not one. Not even you. You sweet little person, you. There's no good person. Matter of fact, I had to memorize Psalm 16:2. Apart from you, O Lord, I have no good thing. Because sometimes I think I have a good thing. It don't take much. Please don't give me any compliments. I start getting puffed up so quick. Thank you, Pastor Mark. That was a good word. Thank you. I have no words. I'm just a vessel. There's nothing good about me. There's only one who is good. That's our Father in heaven. Amen? So instead of desiring freedom, truth, and abiding in the words of truth, they get offended. How can you call us slaves? We're the offspring of Abraham. You can almost see them beating their chests in pride, their heritage, and where they're from. It's really a strange statement when you think about it, because the Jewish people have been under bondage most of their existence. Egypt, the Philistines, Babylon, Persia, Syria. And even now as they speak these bold words, there's a Roman garrison looking down at them as they stand in the temple courts, boasting of their freedom. There's an apologist by the name of John Gerard who says this of freedom. Biblically speaking, freedom is the ability to function the way God designed us to function. This is the reason why freedom and truth are so intertwined. We need to know what our purpose and design are before we can exercise the freedom to fulfill our mission on earth. I've always had this dream of having a Ferrari, a red Ferrari. I can't afford one, and I know I can't afford one, but I have taught many children over the years, and I think mathematically there's a probability that one of those children may grow up to be so successful in this world that they may be able to afford not only one for themselves, but one for their old crusty teacher. So for years and years, my students would have this, and I don't deal with those mushy emotions very well, so I tend to go to humor quickly. So at some point in the year, a kid will be just very excited and thankful, like, "Coach, I really appreciate you. You do a really good job." I was like, "Oh, I don't do that for you. I just want a red Ferrari." And we've joked about that for years. Did you know that one day I've shared this with you before, I'm walking down my street in this little town, and what's coming down the road? A red Ferrari. I'm like, it's happening. So clearly I didn't believe. I joked about it, but now I'm like, what I'm going to say? I wonder which kid it is. The whole time this car is coming down my little street, I'm like, which kid is this? And I'm thinking, and the car gets one driveway from mine and turns into that driveway, and I see that it's my neighbor driving a red Ferrari. And he's not one of the best neighbors I've ever had. I was like, Lord, that's just mean. Thanks for keeping me straight. But as nice as a Ferrari is, or we believe it is, as much of a marvel the road it is, this man says it's completely useless in the ocean. And his point is, we function at our best when our lives measure up to our designer's specifications. And misunderstanding the kind of freedom Christ offers leads to a distorted view of the nature of sin, which is what's going on right here with these learned teachers of the law. Verse 34 says, Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. Everyone who practices sin, who commits sin, who sins." The verb tense that's used in this passage makes it clear that this is talking about a habitual act, a continual action. And it's important to know that, because one of the most frustrating things you'll experience as a believer as you continue to grow in your relationship with Jesus Christ is that you're not 100% rid of sin in your life. Do you not find that so frustrating? You would stomp your foot in the ground like, Lord, make me sinless. I want to be perfect like you, like the word says. You know what would happen if you had no sin in your life? You would think you were that good. There's a day coming when we will be fully fixed. Our flesh will not be what it is. It'll be just like our Savior. We will, and it's hard to get your mind wrapped around this, but as glorious as Jesus Christ is, we share in his suffering, but we also share in his glory. And part of that sharing his glory is he has a resurrected body, and so will we. And our resurrected body will function the way it was always meant to function, in line, in step with our Father. I'm looking forward to that day, aren't you? The person who lives in habitual sin is a slave of sin. So habitual sin is, it's a part of your daily life. Jesus teaches them a deep but obvious spiritual truth. In this world, you see slavery and have known slavery, but the real slave master in all our lives is sin. You walk around in chains of sin and profess freedom. The natural man walks in continual habitual sin, unaware he's a slave. The man of God walks in continual repentance and praise, aware, fully aware that he's been set free. Verse 35 says, the slave does not remain in the house forever, the son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Jesus teaches them that not only are they slaves of sin, but the slave cannot stay in the father's house forever, only the son remains forever. But if the son sets you free, you are free forever. A slave by himself can't change his status. The liberator of bondage has to come from outside. Verse 37 says, I know that you are offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me because my word finds no place in you. Abraham was their father genetically, but not spiritually. When messengers from heaven came to Abraham, he received them. The Pharisees do not receive Jesus. They reject him, and they seek to kill him. Abraham would not do this. This is not the nature of the children of Abraham. Verse 38 says, I speak of what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have heard from your father. So Jesus reminds them that he did what he did was consistent with his father, and what they did was consistent with their father. I speak of what I have seen with my father. You do what you have heard from your father. Colossians chapter 1 says, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. John of the gospel we're studying now, chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. Jesus speaks of things he has seen with his Father, because he and his Father are one. And Jesus contrasts this to the Jews. You were not with Abraham. You did not see what Abraham did. You only heard about it. And by the way, Abraham's not your father. In verse 39, they answered him, Abraham is our father. And Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would be doing the works Abraham did. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. The religious leaders protested that Abraham was their true father. Jesus agrees that they're descendants of Abraham, but they're not children of Abraham. They're not children of Abraham in their actions, in their thoughts. They sought to kill Jesus. Abraham embraced him. Jesus exposed the inconsistency of their life. They said they were children of Abraham, but they didn't act like it. Children who take pride in their parents and who claim to be associated with their parents, they take on their characteristics, their beliefs, and practices, and they take pride in that. Many of you have had a parent or a grandparent that you've looked up to, and you've seen how they've done things, and you said, I'm going to be like that. Amen? Sometimes we have the reverse. Sometimes we have parents, and you go, that is not how you do it. And that is not how I'm going to be. But you still get your eyes on someone who becomes a pseudo-father or pseudo-mother for you, and you go, that's how it's supposed to be. They said they were the children of Abraham with their mouth, but their life didn't reflect it. 1 John chapter 3 starts off this way. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Do we say we are children of God and don't act like it? I mean, it's easiest for read about the Pharisees. I mean, it's very easy for us to read about these Jewish leaders and go, yep, they were messed up. I can't believe they would do that. Shame on them. But a lot of times we see ourselves doing the same thing. Do we say we're children of God and not act like it? Let's take a look and see. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3 says, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. Have we truly set our mind on things above? Is that where we're operating day by day? Is that what's driving us? Jesus exposes our inconsistencies with his word. Jesus tells them that we need to abide in my word. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing the soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. I talk to many, many people that say, man, I've got to get back into the word. I got to get back into making time. I've gotten off track. I've gotten busy. This has come up. That's come up. I'm not where I used to be. I was in a good place. I was consistent. Maybe the reason we find it so hard to find time to be in the Word is because we find it difficult to be in the Word. Maybe the experience of having the Word penetrate deeply into our hearts is something that our flesh desperately avoids and will get you to do anything other than spending time in the Word. The flesh does not have any desire to have its thoughts and attitudes judged. Psalm 19, verse 7 through 11 says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward." When I just read the Word of God to you, did it resonate with you? Did you feel the truth wash through you? We have to abide in His Word. Verse 41 says, "You are doing the works your father did." They said to him, "We were not born of sexual immorality. We have one Father, even God." You hear what they just did there? When we want to be right, we get ugly with people real quick. Now, I know y'all are good, God-fearing, love Jesus, light of the world Christians. Amen? And you would never be ugly to people. You'd never cut somebody off driving because they were idiots. We would never call someone an idiot. Right? We would never lose patience with someone who was serving us food and judge them. We would never get angry with a business or an establishment because they weren't up to our standards. We don't do things like that, right? That's the world. The world does that. But when we let our flesh take over, by the way, I say we, I'm the biggest part of the we can get ugly with people real quick. Matter of fact, if we just paused right now and went around the room and said, "Have you been ugly to someone this week?" And we'd be like, "Yeah." But it was justified. And we'd want to tell the story about what happened. What's our mission as a child of God? What's our calling? Seek first the kingdom of God. Are we on a mission? I think we're called to go forth to the whole world and make disciples, teaching them what Jesus taught. Isn't that what we're called to do? So let me get this straight, disciple maker. We start off by calling someone an idiot, judging them, fussing at them, putting them in their place, and it was like, "Oh, yeah, Jesus loves you. Everything I do is driven by my love for Christ." Like, really? They said to Jesus, "We were not born of sexual immorality." Just like they did back in verse 19, the Pharisees make a personal attack about the parentage of Jesus. They imply that he's an illegitimate child, that he's a child conceived from immorality. In Luke chapter 1, it clearly tells us that Jesus was born of a virgin. But because we live in a small town, we know that everyone knows everyone's business. And the word was out about Jesus in his small little town community, about Mary and Joseph. Did you know Mary had a baby? Mm-hmm, sure did. Oh, that must be why she left town. She went to stay with a relative. She got pregnant. That's so shameful. She was a good girl, too. Can you hear it? You didn't think that they were different than we are today. Listen, ladies, I love you. I really do. But you keep the gossip, train rolling. And I say ladies, not that men don't do this, but men continually fail at finding out details. I'll come home from meeting someone, my wife will ask me questions like, are they married? I don't know. How do y'all know? I didn't ask. Do they have kids? I don't know. Did they say where they moved here from? I don't know. Did they tell you about what happened, what caused? I don't know. And that leads to the final question my wife asked me. What do you know? Did you even talk to them? Like, yeah, I talked to them, but not about that stuff. And she's like, well, what else is there to talk about? The stuff we talked about. Listen carefully. The next time you're trying to get the scoop, trying to get someone to spill the tea, ask yourself sincerely, what's the intent of my heart right now? What am I trying to find this information for? What's the purpose? The heart of gossip is to tear down, to kill, steal, and destroy. And that's not the work of our Father in heaven. I've seen such evil intent come out of good people. We're not called forth to bring division, to cause harm, to tear people down. Colossians 3, chapter 3, verse 12 and 14 says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with one another and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Listen, the world is mean enough. The world is evil enough. The world is hateful enough. It does not need you to add bitterness and darkness to it. The world doesn't need bitterness and darkness from you. It needs a Savior. It needs light. You must be filled with Christ to admit the light of Christ. Verse 42, Jesus said to them, if God were your Father, you would love me. For I came from God and I am here. I came not of my own accord, but he sent me. Why do you not understand what I say? It is because you cannot hear my word. You can't claim God as your Father without loving me. The two can't go together, separate. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, is what Jesus tells us. Jesus explained that the problem with their lack of understanding was rooted in their failure, even their inability to listen and understand his word. And then verse 44, we just get straight to the punch. You are of your father, the devil. You want a question about who my father is? You don't even know who your father is. You're of your father, the devil. You think you're of Abraham, but you're not. You're of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Jesus moves from implying that Abraham is not their father to spelling it out for them. Not only is Abraham not your father, but you don't even realize who your real father is. Your real father is the devil. You think that went over well? Your daddy is the devil. You have all his characteristics. You do his desires. You desire to murder me. You stand against the truth. You lie because it's your natural character and it's your nature to lie. Just like your daddy, the devil. We have to hear that because if we're not careful, these were religious people. These were people that had put following the Lord up here to a higher degree than you can even imagine. It was infused in all about their life, but they didn't even realize in their effort to follow the Lord that they were so broken and corrupt. Galatians chapter 5, we're familiar with the fruits of the Spirit, but it's a good comparison of the acts of the flesh versus the Spirit. We don't have any of the fruit of the Spirit apart from the Holy Spirit indwelling in us. It's not natural. We know the works of the flesh: sexual immorality, impurity, idolatry, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions. Do we find these things in the church? Yes. Because people that are in the church have flesh. If you don't have flesh, you're dead. But the fruit of the Spirit is something wildly different. It's love. It's joy. Peace. That other word that we try to do, patience. Kindness, good. That's not of us. These are qualities from God Himself, from His Holy Spirit that He puts in us. Those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Again, we're back to a daily abiding, abiding, abiding. We can't do these things on our own. We weren't meant to do them on our own. We are a part of Christ. He is a part of us. You are of the Father, the devil, and your will is to do your Father's desires. Verse 45 says, "But because I tell you the truth, you do not believe me. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I tell the truth, why do you not believe me?" Jesus gives his enemies an opportunity to declare some sin in him. What a bold statement. And they could not. Who could say this but Jesus? We couldn't say that. Only the spotless Lamb without blemish, the Lamb of God, could say such a thing. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us." Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin." And it ends with verse 47. "Whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is that you are not of God." Jesus starts off this, he knows that they claim to believe him, they're hearing him, but he's like, it's a lot deeper than what you realize, and he walks them through it. The gospel is the good news. Amen? Do you know what comes before the good news? The awful news, the bad news, the horrible news. News like this: you're of the Father, you're devil. You're an enemy of the Most High God. You have delighted and enjoyed in doing evil. There is no hope for you to ever be reconciled with God. You are a slave to the sin that will bring eternal death to you. You cannot set yourself free. You are chained forever, imprisoned in your sins. You will spend all eternity separated from God. You have enjoyed God's grace and mercy daily. Didn't even realize it was His grace and mercy, even in your sins, but death is coming. Would you say that's bad news? Matter of fact, that's such bad news that everything inside of you wants to say, "Nuh-uh, that's not true, that can't be." God in His goodness, His majesty and His glory looked down on you in your awful state and said, "I love you so much, I will send my Son, my only begotten. I will put all of your sins on Him, I will put the blame on Him, and I will make Him pay. He will be mocked, He'll be spit on, He'll be hated, He'll be beaten. His flesh will be ripped from His body. He will hang on a cross meant to degrade Him. He will do all of this because He loves you and I love you. Believe in Him and be reconciled. Believe in Him and be washed clean of all your sin. In Christ, you can become a new creation. You will have a new heart, new desires. In Christ, you will not be an enemy of God, but a child of God. In Christ, you will not be a slave of sin, but a servant of the Most High God, forever free of sin, in the bondage of sin. The cross, meant to degrade Christ, gave him the name above all names. Worthy is the Lamb to receive praise and honor. We're told that if we are willing to suffer with Christ as Christ suffered, we'll share in his glory. That's wild to even get your mind around. In Revelation chapter 5, it says, "Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, 10,000s times 10,000s. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders, and in a loud voice they were saying, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise.' Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, 'To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever.'" If you haven't put your faith in Jesus Christ, do it today. Don't even wait. If you have questions about it, you can ask Pastor Zane, you can ask me. As a matter of fact, there's people all in this room would love to sit with you and talk with you. But for those of us that believe and follow, we need to make sure that we're abiding in him. If we call ourselves true disciples, he laid it out for us. Amen? We're going to close out and go into a time of reflection. And we have a time of reflection every week. Sometimes I worry that we don't have a lot of reflecting. I think sometimes in our time of reflection, we start reflecting on our hunger pain, our lunch plans, making sure we get the kids picked up, who's going to do what we got going on in the afternoon. And listen, no judgment. I know that happens, but the time of reflection is not for that. We just walked through the Word of God, and we invited the Holy Spirit to come in here, and God wants you to be equipped. He wants you to be changed. He doesn't want you to leave this place today just like you were when you came in. He wants you to grow up and mature. And if the Holy Spirit has been gnawing at you and convicting you of things, you need to deal with it. And if you've been encouraged, you need to deal with that too. And we have a time of reflection. That's so that you can honor what the Spirit's doing with you. And if you need to come up here and pray, pray. If you need someone to come with you, just grab them and say, "Come on, I need you." If you need one of the pastors, we're here for the time of reflection. So let's not turn that time of reflection to just a procedure that we do. Amen? Father, we come before you. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we just looked at and studied your word today. Lord, we have given you praise and worship. But in your word, it tells us that true disciples abide in your word and know your truth. Lord, we have freedom by believing the words of Christ. Lord, we have freedom in Christ. Lord, our faith in Christ needs to be more than words. May our faith be actions. May it be evident in the words that we say, the things that we do. Father, we're called to make disciples. Lord, we weren't saved to enjoy this life. Lord, just as Abraham believed in the promise that you gave him, he didn't know where the land was, what it looked like. He just knew it had to be true. Father, we know there's a land, there's a home for us, and it's not here. Lord, you're not of this world, and in Christ, we're not of this world. We're sojourners. But Father, while we're here in this temporary home, may we be faithful servants that serve you. And Father, when we don't abide in your word, It affects us. It hurts us. It affects our families, our loved ones, the people in our lives, our community. Because when we're not abiding in your word, Father, we're not abiding in you. And we feel far from you, even though you're not far. It's our affection that's far, because we set our affection on other things. So, Father, there's anyone in this place today that needs to make things right, I pray that they would boldly come forward. Father, if you're working in someone's heart right now, Lord, I pray that you would just not let them ignore you. Lord, that they would just deal with it right now, be done with it. You don't want us to carry those burdens. We cast our burdens on you. And Father, if there's anyone here that does not know your Son as Lord and Savior, I pray they would know how simple it is. Believing in the heart that your Lord, confessing with their mouth that he's the Christ, had died for their sins and was raised 3 days later, and that we're washed clean fully of our sins forever because of the work he did on the cross. It's too good to be true, but it is true. You are that good. Lord, we thank you for the salvation we have in your Son. We thank you for the word that you give us so that we can grow and mature and know what it is to be a child of God. Help us to do that well. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love.
to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God.
There we go. Amen. Thank you, Becky. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, man. What a wonderful thing it is to be a child of God. To know that my sins have been paid for and covered. And thankfully, I'll never see the justice that really is mine. I told my students years ago, God's not fair, and it sure is a good thing he's not. Because if God gave me what was fair, he gave me mercy, he gave me grace. All because of what his son has done. Man, what a good thing it is to be a child of God. All right, for this week, we do have youth back on tonight. Converge Youth is happening this evening. Is the Bible study happening? Is she doing it online tonight? Does anybody know? No. It's not? Okay. All right, so the Matthew Bible study is not going on this afternoon, but Converge is. Wednesday night, we do have Awana going, and we have our community groups in Laurel Island and on Grayfield. They are both going this week. I don't know, you probably noticed, many of you probably noticed that there are a bunch of Operation Christmas Child boxes out in the foyer. It is that time of year. We would like to encourage you to grab your box or 10 or 15, however many you want to grab, and load them up. And with those boxes, you will find there a stack of these. Operation Christmas Child, the Samaritan's Purse, has asked that you no longer put a check in the box inside the box like you have in the past, because they have found that a lot of checks have been lost that way. So you can pay online. You can go online and pay for shipping on boxes, or you can take one of these handy dandy things here that is a self posted envelope. They've paid for it. You stick your check right in there and mail it to Operation Christmas Child. That way it doesn't get put in a shoebox, and then somehow or another in the moving and packing of the boxes, the checks get lost. All right. So if you want to pay online, that's great and fine. If you want to grab one of these envelopes, postage paid, you can grab that. That is fine also. But yes, get your shoeboxes. This coming Saturday, October the 23rd at 10 a.m., the church box packing party is happening here in the fellowship hall. So if you can come and want to be part of that, we'll have all the supplies there. Many of you have been a part of this, participated in it for a long time. And if you don't know what it is, well, we're going to pack a bunch of shoeboxes, and we would love to have you come and help pack that up so that we can get as many shoeboxes on the way to these children all around the world. And I'll tell you, it is a wonderful thing. What was it? Was it 17 we went to Romania? 18. Me and Misty and Carrie, we went to Romania the week of Thanksgiving of 2018, and we got to meet some of the kids on the other side of Operation Christmas Child. And what a wonderful thing it was for me to meet some of these kids and love on some of these kids, just hang out with the kids who we've been doing Operation Christmas Child for many, many years, but to finally see the other side of it, and what a blessing it is. And I'll just tell you, you just have no clue the difference that is being made in these kids' lives all around the world through simple things such as these shoeboxes. And Samaritan's Purse does a wonderful, wonderful ministry in this, because not only did they get this gift, but Samaritan's Purse is very, very careful that they share the gospel with these kids, and they carry them through a time of training and teaching about the things of Jesus. And their lives are being changed, not just on earth, but for eternity through this ministry. So please, be a part of it. It's a wonderful thing, and it doesn't take much of your time or much of your money to participate. We would love to have you be part of it. So remember, our box packing party is this coming Saturday at 10 in the morning. Anything else I need to announce? Anybody got anything? Yes, tomorrow night, men to men, women to women, will be taking place right here in the building. All right? All right, y'all stand with me. Let's pray. We'll go find a wish sandwich somewhere. You know what a wish sandwich is, right? It's two pieces of bread and you wish you had something between them. Let's pray, guys. Father, we love you so much. We are so thankful for your great love for us. Thank you that you loved us so much, that you did send your only son. Lord, we are so thankful that the promise is because of him, we can be reconciled. We, our sins can be forgiven, and we can be saved, and we can be part of your family to be with you forever. We are thankful that the word is true, that you loved the world so much that you sent your only begotten son, that whoever would believe in him should have eternal life. Thank you for that. Thank you for the reminder of that today. Thank you for this message that you've given us as Jesus is teaching people hard truths. And as he taught those people there that day, Lord, I pray that it has resounded in our hearts. Truly, Lord, there is nothing good in us. Apart from you, there is nothing good in us. That the prophet Jeremiah, he was 100% accurate when he said that the heart of man is desperately wicked and deceitful above all things. Who can know it? Lord, I have found that to be true in my life and in every life that I've encountered. Deep down in our natural state, we are desperately wicked people. We can't even trust our own hearts. But because of Christ, we can be made new. We can be forgiven. We can be called righteous in your sight because he has applied his righteousness to our account. Thank you for that. And God, I just reiterate what my brother said this morning. If there be one who has never trusted in Christ, even now, Lord, as we're going home, Lord, I pray that if there be one who has never trusted in Christ, that they would understand the seriousness of the situation. And God, they would find one of us, somebody here in this room to talk to find out what it really means to follow you. And God, for every one of us, as we leave this place,